يقول الله سبحانه وتعالى والشمس وضحاها والقمر إذا تلاها والنهار إذا جلاها والليل إذا يغشاها والسماء وما بناها والأرض وما طحاها والنفس وما سواها فألهمها فجورها وتقواها قد أفلح من زكاها وقال الله سبحانه وتعالى يوم لا ينفع مال ولا بنون إلا من أتى الله بقلب سليم وقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم في حديث أبي عبد الله نعمان بن بشير رضي الله عنه ألا إن في الجسد مضغة إذا صلحت صلح الجسد كله وإذا فسدت فسد الجسد كله ألا وهي القلب Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in many verses in the Quran, he makes oath. Meaning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he swears by something. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, lahu an yuqsimu bima yasha. Allah has a right to swear by anything he wants to from his creation. And the purpose of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala making an oath or swearing by something is to stress on a point, emphasize a point, or show the importance of a thing. So for example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in assuring the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, مَا وَدَّعَكَ رَبُّكَ وَمَا قَلَى That your Lord has not abandoned you, nor has he forsaken you, to assure the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam of this point. How did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala begin the surah? وَالْدُّحَى Allah ta'ala said, I swear by the day. وَالْلَيْلِ إِذَا سَجَى And I swear by the night when it follows it. مَا وَدَّعَكَ رَبُّكَ وَمَا قَلَى Your Lord has not abandoned you, nor has he forsaken you. To show that mankind is in a state of loss, except for those who believe, do righteous actions, enjoin each other upon that which is good, and enjoin each other upon patience, Allah Ta'ala says, إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسُرٍ Mankind is in a state of loss. And two, emphasize this point. Allah Ta'ala makes an oath in the beginning. Allah Ta'ala says what? Wal asri. I swear by time. So we find many ayats like this in the book of Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala. But the verses I read to you in the beginning, Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala did not swear by one or two or three or four or five things from his creation to emphasize a point. Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala in seven ayat, he swore by seven of his creations. To show the importance of this point, Allah Ta'ala says, وَالشَّمْسِ وَضُحَاهَا I swear by the sun and the bright and its brightness. وَالْقَمَرِ إِذَا تَلَاهَا I swear by the moon as it follows it. وَالنَّهَارِ إِذَا جَلَّاهَا I swear by the day as it appears. وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا يَغْشَاهَا And I swear by the night as it follows it. وَالسَّمَاءِ وَمَا بَنَاهَا I swear by the heavens and the one who built it. وَالْأَرْضِ وَمَا طُحَاهَا And I swear by the earth and the one that laid it out. وَالنَّفْسٍ وَمَا سَوَّاهَا And I swear by the soul and the one that created it. So what point is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala emphasizing here? Allah ta'ala says, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا Whoever purifies his soul is the successful one. And this shows the importance of purification of our hearts and our soul. That Allah Ta'ala swore by seven things. Because that which you're going to call to account, your qiyamah, is based on the contents of our chest. As Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala says, يَوْمَ لَا يَنْفَعُ مَالٌ وَلَا بَنُونَ On that day, wealth or children will not benefit. إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهَ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ Except for the one who comes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with a heart which is pure. أَفَلَا يَعْلَمُ إِذَا بُعْثِرَ مَا فِي الْقُبُورِ Do they not know when the graves will be scattered that day? وَحُسِّلَ مَا فِي الصُّدُورِ And the contents of the chest should come out. This shows the importance of the heart. That's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, there's a piece of flesh in the body. If it's pure, the whole body is pure. If it is corrupt, the whole body is corrupt. And this piece of flesh is the what? The heart. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he said this in a hadith, he shows the importance of staying away from doubtful matter, doubtful ideologies, and doubtful people. What is the connection between this hadith of there's a piece of flesh in the body? If it's pure, the whole body is pure. If it's corrupt, the whole body is corrupt. What is the connection with this and staying away from doubtful matter? Because what I've mentioned to you from the hadith is the last part of the hadith. How does the hadith begin? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, in the beginning, inna al-halala bayyin. The halal is clear. Wa inna al-haram bayyin. And that which is haram is very, very clear. Wa baynahuma mushtabihat. La ya'lamuhunna kathiru minan nas. And between the two, a gray and doubtful affairs. Many people do not know the ruling and the answers on these doubtful affairs. فَمَنِتَّقَى الشُّبُهَاتِ. As for the one that stays away from doubtful matters, fears them. فَقَدِ اسْتَبْرَأَ لِدِينِهِ وَعِرْضِ. He protects his religion and he protects his honor. So part of protection of our heart is to stay away from doubtful matters. And the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Sahaba, they made the utmost effort to stay away from doubtful matters. They looked for the guidance of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in how to stay away from doubtful matters and fitna. So Hudhayfa ibn Yamah radiallahu anhu, to show the eagerness and the yearning of the Sahaba in staying away from doubtful matters, he said, "Kunna inda Umar." Once we were with Umar radiallahu anhu, and Umar radiallahu anhu, he said to them, أيكم سمع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يذكر الفتنة. Which one of you could relate to us a hadith in which the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم mentions fitna, the trials and tribulations that overcome this ummah? حذيفة بن يمان said, فقال قوم سمعناه. The people, some people stood up and said, we've heard. And Umar رضي الله عنه said, maybe what you're talking about, فتنة الرجل في أهله وجاره. Is the fitna, the trials and tribulation of a person in his wealth or his family and his neighbors. He said that for this kind of fitna, to kafiruha as-salah was-siyam was-sadaqah. You could overcome that fitna with prayers, fasting, and charity. He said the fitna I mean, allati tamuju mawjal bahr. The fitna that is so great that his waves are like the waves of the ocean. At that point, everybody kept quiet, except for Hudhayfa ibn Yaman. He's the only one that stood up. He said, I've heard of this fitna. He said, سَمِعْتُ النَّبِيَّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ يَقُولُ. I heard, and pay attention to this fitna, my brothers and sisters. I heard the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam saying, that تُعْرَضُ الْفِتَنُ عَلَى الْقُلُوبِ كَالْحَصِيرِ. That fitna, trials and tribulations, will overcome the people and it will be presented to the hearts like a straw mat, a reed mat. And a straw mat is made of what? Of straws. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, this fitna will come udan udan, one straw at a time, one at a time. فَأَيُّ قَلْبٍ أُشْرِبَهَا نُكِتَ فِيهِ نُكْتَةً سَوْدَى. Whichever heart allows it to enter into it, it will have a black spot. وَأَيِّ قَلْبٍ أَنْكَرَهَا. Whichever heart rejects it, نُكِتَ فِيهِ نُكْتَةٌ بَيْضَى. You have a white spot on the heart. حَتَّى تَصِيرْ عَلَى قَلْبٍ. Until there'll be two kinds of hearts. عَلَى قَلْبٍ أَبْيَضٍ. A heart which is pure because he rejects the fitna, rejects the doubtful matters. مِثْلُ الصَّفَى. Like that of a gemstone. لَا تَدُرُّهُ فِتْنَةً مَا دَامَتِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. It will never be affected by fitna as long as the heavens and the earth, they endure. وَقَلْبٌ. And a heart, آخر أسود, a completely black heart. مِرْبَاد, dusty. A heart, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, كَالْكَوْزِ مُجَخِيَ, like a cup which is upside down. A cup which is upside down, no matter what you pour into it, there's no benefit. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "La ya'rifu ma'rufan." He will no longer know that which is good. "Wa la yunkiru munkaran." And he will never reject any evil, except for that which his heart soaks up from his desire. In this hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, a number of benefits, especially in the time we're living in now. The first benefit from this hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the wajib or the wujub, and it's important for us to make ourselves understand the magnitude of certain words. When someone says something is wajib, it's obligatory, leaving it off is a sin. This hadith, it shows the obligation of staying away from doubtful matters and doubtful ideologies. Obligatory upon all of us. Because fitna, trials and tribulations, from the great of it is shubuhat, doubtful matters. Because doubtful matters or shubuhat comes from the Arabic word tishbih, similar to tishbih, which means resemblance and similarity. And they say shubuhat is called shubuhat li-ishtiba'ihi bil-haqqi. Because it bears some resemblance to the truth. It seems like it's true. It bears similarity to the truth. And that's why people fall into it. Because it is doubtful. It looks like the truth, but you know it is doubtful. So it's one of the greatest fitna. And that's why the scholars in the past, they used to advise their students. And these students they were advising were scholars in their own rights. Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, لا أعلم, I have no idea of a wasiyah, an advice, intafa'tu bihi, that I benefited from in repelling doubts that advised Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah azza wa jal. Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah azza wa jal said to Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah, and Ibn Qayyim was a scholar. Ibn Qayyim was relating to him foreign ideas, strange ideas he's heard of, and doubtful matters. So he said to him, لا تجعل قلبك للإرادات والشبهات. Do not make your heart become for doubtful matters and strange affairs like a sponge that soaks it all up. But make your heart كالزجاج مصمتة. Make your heart like that glass which is solid, that everything passes over it, but it doesn't go into it. A glass which is so clean that he sees the doubtful matter, but due to his strength, the doubtful matter does not enter into it. Otherwise, every single doubt will enter into your heart. If this is the advice of Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah azza wa jalla, or Ibn Taymiyyah to Ibn Qayyim, to a scholar, what about us, the layman? The layman, what about us? Should we engage in doubtful matters, doubtful ideologies, in the name of a debate, in the name of discussion, or in the name, I know my religion well enough, I'm immune from these doubtful matters, or listen to doubtful people? We shouldn't. Even if you know it's upon falsehood. Because the Dajjal, who the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he described in intricate details to this ummah. Are there people from this ummah that follow the Dajjal? They are. And some of the people that follow the Dajjal, how would they follow the Dajjal? To go and debate with him, even written before his, on his forehead is kafir. But yet they will follow him, because they went to debate with him. So what many people do, listening to doubtful issues, doubtful ideologies, be on the internet, all the social media, the scholars will stay away from this. So what about the layman? The second benefit from this hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the obligation to reject, refute any type of shubuhat, any type of doubts or strange ideologies. Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Ayyu qalbin ankaraha," the heart that rejects it. Any heart that rejects it will have a white mark upon it. It's obligatory to reject any strange and doubtful matters. Because we all know that from Iman, our faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to reject all evil. As the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Man ra'a minkum munkaran falyughayyiru biyadi. Whoever sees an evil from amongst you should change it with his hand. If he could not, then with his tongue. And if he could not, then with his heart. And that is the weakest of Iman. So evil we have to reject. So I ask you, my brothers and sisters, for somebody to innovate in the deen of Allah, is it an evil? No doubt. Because with that action is denying the saying of Allah Azza wa Jal. Al-yawma akmaltu lakum deenakum. Today I've completed your religion for you. So why are you adding to the religion? Is it an evil? Yes, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Man ahdafa fi amrina hadha ma laysa minhu fa warad." Whoever innovates in this religion of ours, that which is not for me is rejected. Is it an evil? Yes, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Kullu bid'atin dalala." Every bid'ah, no matter how much is beautified, is a dalala, is a misguidance. Wa kullu dalala fi an-nar. And every single misguidance is in the hellfire. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made it that from Iman reject evil, and bid'ah is an evil. So whoever sees the evil of bid'ah, let him change it with his hand, if he has the ability and the authority. And if you look at our salaf, our scholars, like Imam Malik rahimahullah azza wa jal, once a person was in a masjid and he asked Imam Malik rahimahullah azza wa jal, that, ya Imam, we know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala istawa. Allah is above his throne. Walakin, but, kayfa istawa? How did he rise above his throne? Imam Malik rahimahullah ta'ala started to hit his head from the magnitude of the question that was being asked. Imam Malik rahimahullah ta'ala, he started to sweat. And he said to this individual, Al-istiwa ghayru majhool. The fact that Allah is above his throne is not something unknown. Wal kayf, as for how? Ghayru ma'kool. You could not comprehend it. Was-su'al anhu bid'ah. And to ask about it is an innovation. Wa ma araka illa mubtadi'an. I do not see you except to be a man on innovation. Imam Malik rahimahullah ta'ala ordered for this man to be physically picked up and ejected out of the masjid. Because of munkar. Whereas today, we may talk about the evil of alcohol consumption, zina, theft, other crimes, and people say we have to forbid it. But hardly from those who forbid these, forbid the evil of bid'ah. People think munkar is just these sins. They'll forbid these things, but bid'ah they'll not forbid it. Likewise, we have to reject it with our tongue. Speak against it. It's an obligation to reject it with your tongue. If you cannot fit, and those who propagate and call to this innovation of doubtful affairs. And this is the way of our forefathers. This is the way of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to speak against innovation and call it what it is. Bid'ah, bid'ah. A bid'ah, they call it a bid'ah. They won't give it any other name. Because unless we do so, it starts to seem fair seeming and okay. Like sins, adultery, fornication, to make it fair seem what they call it. Affair. Sodomy, they give it another name. And so on and so forth. Intoxications, they give it other names. Likewise, bid'ah, it becomes fair seeming when people change it. They say we're only doing this out of the love of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And not only beautiful words, they beautify with beautiful decorations, their bid'ah. Not only they beautify with this beautiful decoration, they beautify with beautiful speech. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Inna min al-bayan nasihah." Some speech are magic. Do not make your criteria to listen to any speaker. How eloquent the orator skills he's got. How he moved your heart and your heart fizzed. La. In the time of Ahmed rahimahullah ta'ala, there was a man that people used to become Muslims or repent and go back to Allah. He had beautiful, eloquent speech. Once Imam Ahmed rahimahullah ta'ala, he went to sit in the company of this man to listen to him. So eloquent and so touching was his speech, Imam Ahmed rahimahullah ta'ala cried. But after hearing what he said from innovations, Imam Ahmed rahimahullah ta'ala warned his students and the whole ummah. He said, "La tujalisu harith fa innahu mubtadi'." Don't ever sit with him, he's a mubtadi'. Not like nowadays, people say, mention some of the good, at least he's doing some good. There's a difference between a mistake and a bid'ah. Everyone has mistakes, myself and everybody. But a bid'ah is different. The one that says mention some good is like the one that talks about the murderer, the killer, the mass murderer. Say, you know what? He was an angel before. You know what? That man that kills and pillages, once a week he goes and gives out sweets in charity. Won't even mention it. So this in itself, this principle is a bid'ah. Because bid'ah is beautified to make it acceptable. And that's what Imam al-Najwi rahimahullah ta'ala says, al-bid'atu mustaqbaha shara'an wa fitratan. Bid'ah is something all of us have, we hate. Within our fitra, our natural inclination by the sharia of Allah Azza wa Jal. لِأَجْلِ أَوْ مِنْ أَجْلِ ذَلِكَ يَسْتَحْسِنُ أَهْلَ الْبِدَعِ بِدَعَهُمْ. And that's why the people of bid'ah, what do they have to do to make you accept it? They beautify it for you. So don't go by beautiful speeches. Don't go by beautiful decoration. Let your criteria be, stay away from doubtful matter. The book of Allah and the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wa akulu qawli hadha wa astaghfirullah li wa lakum. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah. So we know that rejection of bid'ah or any evil is from iman, but specifically bid'ah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in a hadith, مَا مِنْ أُمَّتِي مِنْ نَبِيٍّ بَعَثَهُ اللَّهِ فِي أُمَّةٍ مِنْ قَبْلِي. There's no prophet that Allah sent from any nation before me. إِلَّا بَعَثَ مَعَهُ أو إِلَّا بَعَثَ فِي أُمَّتِهِ حَوَارِيُّونَ وَأَصْحَابٍ. Except he sent with that prophet, disciples and companions. And what did his companions and what did these disciples do? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, يَأْخُذُونَ بِسُنَّتِهِ. They held on to the sunnah of their prophets, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam advised us. When he said, عَلَيْكُمْ بِسُنَّتِي. Hold on to my sunnah. وَسُنَّ خُلَفَاء الرَّاشِدِينَ الْمَهْدِيِّينَ. And the خُلَفَاء الرَّاشِدِينَ الْمَهْدِيِّينَ. عَضُّ. Bite on it with your molar teeth. Don't let it go. Every nation has somebody like this. يَقْتَدُونَ بِأَمْرِهِ. They follow his orders. Until they left, and they left behind them people, يَفْعَلُ أَوْ يَقُولُونَ مَا لَا يَفْعَلُونَ. They say that which they do not do. But worse than that, what do they do? يَفْعَلُونَ مَا لَا يُؤْمَرُونَ. They do that which they have been ordered to do. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, and this is bid'ah now, فَمَنْ جَاهَدَهُمْ فَهُوَ مُؤْمِنٌ. Whoever fights against them is a believer. بِيَدِهِ, with his hands. وَمَنْ جَاهَدَهُمْ بِلِسَانِ. Whoever fights against them with his tongue is a believer. And whoever hates them in his heart is a believer. So the very least is to hate it, and the people that propagate it. Because bid'ah doesn't appear through Wi-Fi signals or in the air. There's people that propagate it. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, وَلَيْسَ وَرَاءَ ذَلِكَ مِثْقَالَ خَرْدَلٍ مِنَ الْإِيمَانِ. Anyone who doesn't at least hate it and them, there's not in him a mustard seed of iman. Because if you have jealousy for the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you should hate it. You should dislike it and those who propagate it. And one of the ways of rejecting or repelling shubuhat, my brothers, and I end with this important point. If you take this only away from the khutbah, please take it away. Is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us here specifically in Qatar, in Doha, with a lot of ni'm, a lot of blessings from the dunya. And there's nothing wrong for us to enjoy the dunya, going out, the security, the peace, the wealth, and the affluence. Nothing wrong with it. قُلْ مَنْ حَرَّمَ زِينَةَ اللَّهِ. Who makes it haram to enjoy it? But we need to appreciate this blessing with what? With worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and with seeking knowledge. It's not excusable that the only time we learn our deen or hear anything, and our children and our wives, is khutbah to Jumu'ah. After that, nothing. After that, nothing. Where's our gratefulness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? We need to learn our religion. And when I say learn our religion, I don't mean go to conferences and talks only, which doesn't teach you the fundamentals. Learn the fundamental of your religion. What you're going to be asked about. Ma Rabbuk, who is your Lord? All of us say our Lord is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But what is Allah? What is the ibadah of Allah? How are you making sure in that ibadah you've prayed, you've done hajj, exactly or as much as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did it? What do we know of fiqh? What do we know of tawheed? What do we know? These fundamental issues is important. Attend a circle, a class, not a lecture or an inspiring talk only. There's nothing wrong with it, but make sure you attend circles. And here the brothers have put a lot of effort into making circles, but hardly anybody turns up. Hardly anybody turns up because we have priorities. And what are these priorities? Imam al-Sheikh Zayd ibn Hadi, he said, لا يجوز لأحد أن يعتذر بدنيا أو بأنه أمي أو بأن له أشغال كذا وكذا. He said it's not permissible for anybody to use the excuse of his worldly affairs, or because he's a layman, or because he has such and such work and busy. He said, بل يجعل في قائمة أعماله التفقه في دين الله ونشر ما علمه. He has to put at the top of his priority, not picnic on the weekend, not going to the park. The top of your priority in everything should be to understand the deen of Allah and to spread it. Because Allah says, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. I did not create jinn and mankind except to worship me. And how are you going to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? عَلَى جَهْلٍ. Upon ignorance. How would you know what is good and what is bad except by the sharia? And that's why they say, الشَّرِيعَ أَوْ الْمَعْرُوفُ مَا عَرَفَهُ اللَّهُ وَأَقَرَّهُ. The ma'roof is that which Allah says is good and is attested to. While munkar, an evil, is that which Allah has rejected and He said is an evil. If you don't know, what will end up happening is, like He said in the hadith, that which is actually ma'roof from the sunnah, you reject it because you're jahil. And that which is munkar, an evil, you accept it. So my brothers and my sisters and our children, upon us is knowledge from the correct sources. Seek knowledge. Seek knowledge. And you have opportunity here. On my recent journey, going to Africa, what I saw and what I witnessed in poor, impoverished, destitute conditions, And there, due to the traffic, people start work at 4:30. They leave for 4:30 in the morning. They come back 9 in the evening. But yet you find amongst these people, Hufad. It moved me. I went to places, I was speaking to some of the children in Arabic, thinking they know one or two words. They were speaking fluent Arabic. Like, MashaAllah, كم تحفظ من القرآن? How much Quran do you know? The girl was only 9 years old. She said, أحفظت القرآن كله. I've memorized the whole Quran. I said, MashaAllah, I was impressed. I was getting excited. The older sister came to me and said, don't be excited. كل هؤلاء حفاظ. Everyone here is a حافظ. And in that situation, in the situation they're in, what is our excuse with the comfort and the, what is our excuse for ourselves, our wives and our children? قُوَ أَنفُسَكُمْ وَأَهْلِيكُمْ نَارًا. Save yourself, save your family for the hellfire. Attend these classes, make it at the top of your priority, inshallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect all of us, our family, مِنَ الْفِتَنِ مَا ظَهَرَ مِنْهَا وَمَا بَطَنْ, from that which is apparent and that which is hidden. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala يُرِينَ حَقَّ حَقًا, show us the haqq, الْحَقْ حَقًا, show us the truth as the truth, وَيُزِقْنَا اتِّبَاعًا, and give us ability to follow it, and falsehood is falsehood, and make us stay away from it. إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَلَائِكَةَ يُصَلُّونَ عَلَى النَّبِيِّ يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا صَلُّوا عَلَيْهِ وَسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا.